Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Come on, put your hand together and give God a praise in the house. Ah, come on, come on. Give him a praise. He's been good all day long. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Those individuals who are 75 years and older, we ask that you would take the front seats up front. You are honored here today. We want to make sure we honor you. Amen. So if you would come on up, amen. My Lord. Until these, take these front seats, amen. Don't worry about you ain't looking like it, amen. Somebody might ask you to move out of there. Amen. They may think you too young to be sitting in that section. You tell them the Lord just been good to me like that. Oh, come on. Amen. We thank God for the blessedness of the Lord in the land of the living. Amen. Anybody know he's a living God? Anybody know that he got some living people? And the living people worship and praise his holy name. My Lord. Thank you so very much. While they're moving, let me take the time to greet you and just welcome you, amen, to the campus here at Mount Olive AME Church, amen. Glad to have you in the house, and thanks so very much to you being here at this district conference that God has provided for us, amen. Anybody know he's just a good God? My Lord. Somebody said he's good all day and all night, too. Amen. I'm so thankful. All the young folk coming up and having their seat, we're just giving them a space. Amen. Amen. Now, y'all don't move them if y'all think they're too young. Amen. We're so thankful for the blessedness of the Lord and the goodness of the Lord in the land of his people. Amen. Mrs. Bird, amen. If y'all would just bring her, amen. Right in the second seat here. Second seat here. If you could you put on that second seat, amen. Praise be to the Lord. Amen. Good to see you. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Come on, let's give Miss Barrett a hand all over the house. Been a blessed spirit in our church and blessing folk for many years. Amen. Amen. Y'all ready to go have some worship in here? Are you ready to have some worship in the house? If you're ready to have some worship, let me hear you make some noise for the Lord. Oh, God. I believe he's ready to have some worship. Since we're in the house, we might as well worship him. Amen. Since we're in the house, we might as well let somebody know that we care about our God. Amen. Since we're in the house, we might as well praise him. Ah, glory to God. Glory to God. Ah, let's praise God from whom all blessings flow. Call to worship. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt God's name together. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt God's name together. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt God's name together.
God has brought us thus far, as we have been led into this
now at this time, amen, we will follow the program as printed.
From the AME hymn, hymn number 375, I want Jesus to walk with me.
Right.
I want Jesus to walk with me all along this pilgrim journey. I want Jesus to walk with me. Let us sing this song during this time of celebration with uplifted voices, as they would have done in the church of old.
Want Jesus to walk with me. I want Jesus to walk with me along, all along my pilgrim journey. I want Jesus to walk with me. Dear Heavenly Father, here we are once again, the outstanding Orlando district have come from various places, oh God, to come and to worship and to praise your holy name in spirit and in truth. Oh God, we thank you for blessing us with traveling mercy. We thank you for watching over us through danger seen and unseen. God, we thank you for allowing us to come to your house one more time. God, we won't invite you into the house because we know that you're already here. And so, God, we ask that you would stir up the spirit on the inside of us, oh God. God, we ask that you anoint every place, every pew, every person, anoint the parking lot, everywhere, oh God. Allow us to feel your power and your presence. God, we don't want this to just be another gathering. God, we want to have an encounter with you. So have your way, God, today. God, we thank you for our leadership, God. We ask that you continue to keep your hands upon her. Continue to give her the godly wisdom and understanding to lead us to higher heights. God, we thank you for the pastors and the ministers and the leaders and the members that are here today, God, that makes up this outstanding Orlando district. Continue, oh God, to gel us together. Continue to make us like a district like never before. God, have your way in this place. We thank you for those who are 75 and above. We thank you for every contribution they've made, oh God, to our Zion. We thank you for how they've been dedicated and loyal and committed in our churches, oh God. God, we thank you in the midst of their pains and trials and tribulations, they continue to stay committed to our church. God, we thank you right now. We come today to celebrate them. Have your way, God. God, bless the man of God that will be bringing forth the word, God. God, we pray that you give him strength and boldness and courage and a word to share with us on today. Have your way in this place. God, I don't know, God, but somebody in here might be sick. And they might, their body may be racking with pain and it's causing them not to praise you and to glorify your name. So right now, God, in the name of Jesus, touch them from the top of their head to the soles of their feet. Somebody is worried today. Somebody is stressed out today, God. But God, I pray right now, God, that you touch them, remove the stress, remove the worrying, God. Let them be free and liberated to worship you in spirit and in truth. God, I pray that this week, that these next 2 days, oh God, that they be some days of God that we are able to grow spiritually. That we're able to grow mentally, oh God. That when we leave here saying, we have been with the Lord. We thank you right now. God, ordain this conference, oh God. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
into heaven, I know.
The white robe in the heaven, I know. The white robe in the heaven, I know.
He never left.
Never left.
for grace.
Thank you,
thank you for mercy.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you,
Jesus.
Thank you
for love.
Thank you
for love.
Thank you
for love.
I've
got to thank you.
Thank you,
Jesus.
Thank you
for grace.
Thank you
for mercy.
Thank you,
Jesus.
Thank you,
Jesus.
Thank you,
Jesus.
Thank you,
Jesus.
Make you feel good, don't it? Hallelujah. Amen. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let me direct your attention to the printed Old Testament text found in the book of Daniel, the 5th chapter, verses 12 through 14. Tune your ear to the word of the Lord. For as much as an excellent spirit and knowledge and understanding, interpreting of dreams and showing of hard sayings and dissolving of doubts were found in the same Daniel, whom the king named Belshazzar, now let Daniel be called, and he will show the interpretation. Then was Daniel brought in before the king, and the king spake unto Daniel, Art thou that Daniel, which art of the children of the captivity of Judah, whom the king my father brought out of Jewry? I have heard of thee, that the spirit of the gods is in thee, and that light and understanding and excellent wisdom is found in thee. The word of God for the people of God.
The epistle, 1 Thessalonians 5th chapter, beginning at verse 8 and concluding this, leaving at verse 18. Let us who are of the day be sober, put it on the breastplate of faith and love, and as a helmet the hope of salvation. For God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. Therefore comfort each other and edify one another, just as you also are doing. And we urge you, brethren, to recognize those who labor among you and are over you in the Lord, and admonish you, and to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake. Be at peace among yourselves. Now we exhort you, brethren, to warn those who are unruly, to comfort the faint-hearted, uphold the weak, be patient with all. See that no one renders evil for evil to anyone, but always pursue what is good both for yourselves and for all. Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing. In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. God's word, believe it.
Let us stand for the God. Hold on, y'all. They summons me at the door. The Gospel of St. Matthew, the 28th chapter, beginning at verse number 16. Then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee, into a mountain where Jesus had appointed them. And when they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even until the end of the world. Amen. The word of God for the people of God.
Let us prepare our hearts and minds for the gift of mission and outreach. For those of you who can and will, we're asking for a $10 offering for the gift of mission. Ushers will serve the people of God. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Lay not up for yourselves upon earth where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. But whatsoever ye would that men should do to you, do ye even so to them. For this is the law and the prophet. Not everyone that said unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he that does the will of my Father, which is in heaven. Zacchaeus stood and said unto the Lord, Behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor. And if I have taken anything from any man by false accusation, I restore him fourfold. He which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly. And he which soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. Every man according as he purposes in his own heart. So let him give not grudgingly, nor of necessity. For God loves a cheerful giver. As we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially unto them who are of the household of faith. Godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we will carry nothing out. All things
here we are again. Today, we see all over this sanctuary smiling faces. Some of us have arrived for this moment, and some are on our way to our most eloquent, charming, and most efficient and capable district leader, the Reverend Valerie Jolene Walker, supportive star, district consultant, Sister Sybil D. Keys, the pastors and spouses, our gems and sparkles of the Orlando District, ministers, our strength of the peppermint, officers, and the entire laity, our hearts of gold, of this magnanimous, graceful, innovative Orlando District of the Central Conference, the 11th Episcopal District of the African Methodist Episcopal Church. As we celebrate on this opening of our district conference, with appreciation of all our dedicated commemorative 75 and above in his service in Christendom, give me my flowers while I yet live, so that I can see the beauty they bring. Speak kind words to me while I can hear them, so that I can feel the comfort they bring. Appreciate. APPRECIAITIE. Appreciate. Presiding Elder Walker says, I must say, I wish to send my appreciation. You deserve a standing ovation. Won't you stand for them? A standing ovation. Genuine is my gratitude, because I really like your attitude. A positive person, I must say, hard works that enjoy to play. I could only say good things. Down through the years, you have toiled night and day with the support of prayer. You have given unwillingly your time, talent, and treasure, expecting nothing in return, but your rewards are stored in heaven to be given by God our Father. But today, at this hour, we pause to say thank you. Thank you for all that you have done at all that you do. For a man's work is not measured so much by his accomplishments, but by the obstacles he overcame while achieving them. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. As we truly love you very, very much, may blessings be restored continually upon all of you in Jesus' name. Love, peace, and hope. To God be the glory. Won't you stand, please? All of our honorees. In the back, you will see their names printed. Let us give them a standing ovation. Thank you.
Hallelujah. God is so good. Good afternoon, church. To Bishop Adam Richardson and Connie Bates Richardson in their absence. To this illustrious group of members of the Orlando District, my colleagues, pastors, ministers, officers, to the wonderful laity and all those that have gathered together this afternoon, I welcome you in the matchless name of Jesus Christ. God has given me an awesome task, and I'm going to do it as briefly and as correctly as I know how. So be a little patient with me, if you will. But when I entered this afternoon, I found my name on program to do such a simple task, and yet it is a major task. It is to present or to introduce somebody that each and every one of us know because she has touched our lives in so many ways. In 2 Timothy, the first chapter and the fifth verse, Paul says to Timothy, I'm reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, and I'm persuaded now lives in you also. I'm persuaded now that that relentless, on fire, fire-baptized, gifted, talented, excited, relentless, stubborn, and willful, and loud, and humble spirit is all inside of whom we call our gracious leader. From the very first day that I met her, I understood that first the Lord had her covering and that she didn't talk from a foolish tongue, but that she gave powerful advice and that which leads others and therefore makes her an excellent leader, bar none. But then I watched her from afar as she was the pastor of Allen Chapel AME in Sanford, and not only was she a wonderful administrative leader, but now I could watch her in a managerial role where she learned how to not only do the job she was called to do by the Lord on fire at all times, but she did it with patience, love, and obedience. And then 3.5 years ago, as we were standing on the annual conference floor, I heard my name and they sent me to a place called New Bethel AME Church in Sanford. Miracle on Main Street, hallelujah. And I stood and I waited in anticipation, anxious to know who was going to be our next leader, who was going to take us into the new age, and who was going to rid ourselves of shackles and chains and bring this church to the glory to which God had declared it so that we could do the work that God had called us to do. Who was going to be that person? That person was in a humble woman who lifted up holy hands, accepted the call, and has done the work. So it's easy for me to stand here and say to you, I thank God for the woman of God that has become our presiding elder. I thank God for the woman that is my friend. I thank God for the woman that is my sister in the cloth. I thank God for the woman that is now the presiding elder of this outstanding Orlando District. Won't you stand to your feet and greet our presiding elder, Reverend Valerie J. Walker.
Man, I whispered to her, I would have been not knowing if I had told her in advance. She just put all that together since she looked at this book and saw that's where she was going. Would you give Ruth Deal another hand? God bless her today. Amen. It was only one adjective. I say, am I stubborn? I said, well, I guess I am. Yeah, I agree with everything she said. But yeah, I guess everybody got a little stubbornness in them. Amen. So I receive that wholeheartedly, and I'll work on that one. Amen. Amen. God bless you. It is just an honor and a blessing to look out over the audience today and see the congregation and see all of our members who have come from near and far over this wonderful, outstanding Orlando district. I know that I am happy and excited and elated to be your presiding elder. So would you give yourselves a hand today? Reverend Susan Johnson and Reverend Deal gave a wonderful protocol, but let me also include my bishop, Adam Jefferson Richardson Jr., and our supervisor, Dr. Connie Spakes Richardson, in my greeting as I get ready to introduce our messenger for the hour. Also, let me include our wonderful First Lady, retired Sister Geraldine Bird. Would you all give her a hand? God bless her. Always elegant and so beautiful. We thank God for her. Let me include our Sister Betty Ivy, who is our Conference Women Missionary President, who has traveled all the way from Daytona to be with her friend, and also her posse, who has come to be with her. Would you all stand, her driving buddies? Would you all stand so that I can recognize you as well? Would you all celebrate Sister Hill? Amen. God bless her as well. Thank you so much for coming to share and to be in the number one more time. And now, would you once again put your hands together for the pioneers, the sages, the seasoned saints, 75 and over, who has traveled all over this church to annual conferences, district conferences, church school convention, our seasoned saints who has reached 7 decades and 80 decades and some 9 decades, 80 years old in between. Would you put your hands together? Some of them are 92, 95. Would you put your hands together? Thank God for their time, their talents, their treasures, all they do to make our churches grow and improve. We thank God for all that they have come to share this day. We praise God for you, you, and you. I am honored to be your presiding elder as I travel to the quarterly conferences and see you make it out even to the quarterly conferences when you could stay home, but you are there. Would you put your hands together one more time and thank our seasoned saints, the pillars of our churches, the ones who have seen this church change. And so we celebrate them today with hymns we prayed that they were familiar with the prayers that was prayed, the dances that were danced in your honor. I say thank you along with the entire Orlando district as well as all of our pastors. Would you stand as well, representatives of all the churches? Come on, pastors, would you stand and also celebrate your members, not only here, but at the various churches. And your names are printed in the worship bulletin. And if your name is not in there, see your pastor. Amen. See your pastor. You all would look at the number of years some have served in the church, the number of years some have served in the various positions they're in as emeritus, as ministers. Do we have any retired ministers here? Any of the retired ministers here? Amen. We celebrate the retired ministers. All of our pastors, if you are retired pastors, would you stand? Amen. Reverend Susie Harris Johnson, a Johnson Harris, amen, retired pastor. All of our deaconesses, would you please stand? Let us see all of our deaconesses, 75 and older. Would you stand that we may recognize you? And God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Amen. 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 Thank you so much. Sister Freeman, remain standing. Sister Joyce Freeman is our newest deaconess who has not been recognized over the years, and she has a certificate. She was made a deaconess under Bishop S.S. Morris. And so we found her certificate, and today we celebrate her as we add her to the distinguished role of deaconesses. Amen. Thank you so much. Praise God. As well as our emeritus officers, if you are here, would you please stand, all of our emeritus officers? Amen. That means you were once stewards, trustees, and stewardesses, but now you are in that high position of being emeritus officers. Thank you so much for your continued faith. All of our officers that are still working, 70 years old and older, would you please stand? 75 and older, still working, still stewards, still trustees, still stewardesses, still making sure the budget's getting paid, still making sure that the church start on time, still keeping the pastor in order. Praise the Lord. Come on, give him a hand. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And then all of our members of the various churches who are here that you have not stood and you are 75 and older, would you please stand so that we may recognize you as well? Amen. Amen. Now that's Sister Martha Harvey. She was to stand with the ministers. She's the minister still ministering in the church. Amen. Over 75 years and older. So truly we are honored today by your presence, and we honor you, and we will be honoring you at a more appropriate time. I pray that the pastors at the local churches, that was one thing I did. We always tried to honor our seniors on the fifth Sunday. The fifth Sundays really don't belong to the missionaries. That's what we gave them so they can help get that budget. But at least once a year, amen, on the fifth Sunday or some Sunday in the year, you ought to take time and celebrate your senior members who are still in the churches to make our churches still continue to grow. And so we honor you and we bless you and we thank you. Now, this is my friend, my mentee, my counselor, the one who believed in me, Reverend James Leanderberg. A man who is a gentleman. Somebody say gentleman. A man who is humble. Somebody say humble. A man who God has put his hands on him and his family, who has been a master pastor in the African Methodist Episcopal Church. Pastored the church at Bethel African Methodist Church in Tallahassee, Florida. I'm sorry. New Mount Zion. He was called to the ministry at Bethel African Methodist Church, but pastored New Mount Zion, amen, congregation for 21 years. Amen. And during those 21 years, the church grew and blossomed, and he invited me to be his revival evangelist, and I believe he had me back four times. And the last time I was there, I said, I don't know why I'm saying this, but I know this is my last year. And then he was elevated to a presiding elder. God blessed him to be the presiding elder over the Pensacola district in the Florida Conference until his retirement at age 75. Would you give him a hand for the work that he has done, the labor that he has given to this church? And he is still active, working on staff at St. Mark AME Church here in Orlando, Florida, under the leadership of Pastor Terrence Gray. So he's not tied yet, and God is not through with him yet. I am honored to have him. He's like a father to me. He is a mentor to me. And he is a spirit, ladies, by which you would love to be married to. So I asked the Lord, I said, Lord, I'm going to try it one more time. I said, what kind of spirit, what kind of husband do I need? Because I don't seem to know how to pick them. And the first spirit that came up in my spirit was a spirit like Reverend Presiding Elder James Leander Byrd. And that's when the Lord put him on my heart today to have him come and share with you, that you could feel his humble, gentle spirit, quiet, meek, and mild, walk with kings, but yet he cares about the common man. He believes in righteousness. He desires to do the right thing all the time. He is well married. He loves his children. He's a praying man. Would you put your hands together for my friend, my mentee, my mentor, my father in the ministry, Reverend Presiding Elder James Leander Byrd. Come on, somebody. Bless him today. Bless him real good. I am humbled and I'm thankful to have him here because he put his hands on me. And anytime somebody put their hands on you, you know you're going places. So I say thank you, thank you, thank you for all you've done for me. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, thank you, Lord. Amen. The next voice you will hear would be the voice of Presiding Elder James Leander Byrd, which I am grateful, humble, thankful, appreciative. We bless God. Amen.
Go! Oh. put your hands together and thank this choir for that tremendous selection. Amen. Amen. To presiding elder Walker, the distinguished and efficient leader of the Orlando district, thank you for the invitation and thank you for your kind words. To our host pastor, Reverend Crutcher, and Reverend Crutcher again. Reverend Crutcher was my first pastor on the Pensacola district. And while I'm in this particular setting, Reverend Crutcher, the reason we're not members of this particular church is because I made a commitment to Pastor Gray prior to coming here. Otherwise, I would have been here. Amen. This presiding elder of yours is one cool chick. Let me say this to you. Be careful how you behave, because somebody is watching you. I heard it from the lips of the supervisor that we had been watching her over the years, and that's why she is where she is. Thank you, Elder. To Mrs. Hill, is that all right? Mrs. Connolly, amen. We go back a bit, amen. And before I get too far with this, let me recognize my bride of 54 years. You can look at her and perhaps say that he robbed the cradle. On the other hand, she could be guilty of robbing the grave. I just like a little humor, y'all. Amen. Your presiding elder made history at New Mount Zion, Tallahassee. We had been inviting men to come and do our revivals. And so some of the ladies said to me, Pastor, we need to invite a female. And so the name that was on my mind, Sister Conley, was this elder. She was pastoring at the time. It's amazing how the Lord works in situations like this. As she said, she served 4 years as our evangelist. We had been inviting Reverend Jimmy Thompson prior to that. And he said that after we invited Reverend Walker, he said that I fired him. But that was not the case at all. Amen. I am indeed happy to be here 85 years young. And I don't give myself any credit for it at all. I give the Lord the credit and all of the glory for allowing me to be here on this day. I won't be long, but I will be long enough. I was a steward at a certain AME church, and the pastor was preaching and preaching and preaching. After about an hour and a half, the steward got up and left. Went to the barbershop. Came back about an hour later, and the pastor was still preaching. So after the service was over, pastor pulled the steward aside and said, "Man, why did you leave church?" He said, "Well, I went to get a haircut." He said, "Why didn't you get a haircut before you came to church?" He said, "I didn't need one then." I promise you, I won't be that long. Let us pray. Lord, stand in my body and help me to preach. Amen. I want to call your attention to the 18th chapter of Genesis. And the first 15 verses of this sermon is centered around. And the subject is there anything too hard for God? Hey, Gene. He was one of my students at FAM. Amen. Many, many years before Christ was born into this world, Abraham and Sarah were leading a normal lifestyle in Canaan. One day, Abraham was seated at the entrance of his tent. He happened to look up and saw three strangers coming in his direction. Keep in mind now that Abraham resides in Canaan, where the weather was pretty warm, like it is here in Orlando this time of year, but without rain. Some of us are old enough to remember the days before AC, when our parents sat on the front porch or under a shade tree, fanning in an effort to keep cool. I believe that Abraham realized these three men were not ordinary people. Perhaps there was something unusual about the way they looked, like we do sometimes. I believe that their countenance was different. Their attire was unique. And their speech was from afar. Notice that Abraham did not reach for his automatic rifle, nor his sword. What does Abraham do? When he sees these three strangers, he gets up from where he was seated to meet them. He even bowed to the ground. Near Eastern hospitality was at its best. In that day, it was common and expected practice to show hospitality to strangers. Notice that Abraham gave prompt attention to the needs of his guests. He hurried to meet them. He bowed down to the ground. Abraham addressed one of the guests as my lord and called himself your servant. Abraham acted as if it would be a favor to him if they allowed him to serve them. He asked that water be brought to wash their feet, an act of courtesy to refresh a weary traveler on a hot and dusty day. Lot, Abraham's nephew, you remember him, extended similar courtesy to two visitors in Genesis 19. Abraham then prepared a lavish meal for his visitors. Amen. A similar lavish offering was presented to a divine messenger when Gideon encountered while threshing wheat in Judges 6. Notice how Abraham stood nearby, assuming the posture of a servant to meet their every wish. That's genuine hospitality. Near Eastern hospitality, not Southern hospitality. When former FBI Director Comey testified that he knew something big was about to happen when President DJT asked everybody to leave a certain room except himself. Well, Abraham knew that something big was about to happen when the three strangers showed up at the front door of his tent. Amen. Amen, windows. By the way, Hebrews 13:2 gives this warning to all of us concerning strangers. Here it is. Do not forget to show hospitality to strangers, for by so doing, some people have shown hospitality to angels without knowing it. While the visitors dine on some young tender beef, fresh off the grill, and whole cake bread, they washed it all down with some cool, delicious buttermilk. After which the visitors asked Abraham this question: where is your wife, Sarah? Notice that the angel did not just say wife, because Abraham had more than one. Don't anybody get any ideas? He designated which wife. She's in the tent, he replied. Then one of them said, I will surely return to you about this time next year. And Sarah, your wife, will have a son. Please pay attention. No mere mortal can make that kind of promise. And it comes to pass unless they have divine connections. That is why I believe, my brothers and sisters, the visitor who made this promise to Abraham was none other than the pre-incarnate Son of God, Jesus the Christ, the precious Lamb of God. Here is evidence that he has always existed in eternity past, way before the Word became flesh in Bethlehem. While the conversation was going on between the visitors and Abraham, Sarah was back in the tent eavesdropping. Let me pause for a moment while I send this text to everybody here who has a smartphone. When you call somebody on your phone, no matter whom you're talking to, don't take for granted that the person on the other end is the only one listening. Moving right along. Keep in mind that Sarah was beyond the age of childbearing.
Abraham was 99 and Sarah was 89. Therefore, she reasoned that they both were too old to cut the mustard. Well, don't take my word for it. She says to herself in part B of verse 12, listen, after I am worn out and my Lord is old, will I now have this pleasure? Then the Lord said to Abraham, why did Sarah laugh and say, will I really have a child now that I'm old? Sarah needed to be careful and not call the Lord a liar. Now there are various kinds of laughter. There is laughter of disbelief, like that of Sarah. Abraham had been guilty of the same thing in Genesis 17. Here Abraham fell face down, laughed, and said to himself, will a son be born to a man 100 years old? Will Sarah bear a child at the age of 90? There is the happy, carefree laughter, too, for children at play. There is laughter that comes when we see the absurdities of life, like the recent testimony from various members of the DJT administration regarding Russia's involvement in the 2016 presidential election. Those who have testified so far are experiencing self-induced amnesia, a subterfuge for lying. There is laughter that comes from hearing a humorous story. Let me slip this one to prove my point. I shared with a friend of mine that I was going to the beach on Memorial Day 2017 to get a suntan. He texted me back and said that I had a greater chance of getting wet. Even though you're a Christian, I hope you did not lose your sense of humor after receiving Jesus in your life. Then there is a loud, coarse laughter coming from a bunch of drunk folk gathered in a bar or a club. Perhaps if they could laugh loud enough, they would be able to drown out their sorrows. Regardless of Sarah's laugh, God's promise came to pass. In the end, she said, God hath made me to laugh so that all that hear will laugh with me. Now, there are instances in Scripture where when the Lord sent an angel to inform some other folk about a pending birth. Don't forget about Hannah, who was promised a son by the name of Samuel. Then there is Elizabeth, the wife of Zechariah. She was too old and barren, but God made it possible for her to give birth to John the Baptist, the forerunner of the Lord Jesus Christ. Certainly, we cannot end this role without mentioning Mary, the mother of our Lord. She was the recipient of a major miracle. All of these events let us know that there is nothing, absolutely nothing, too hard for God. Now, God could have said to Sarah, you laugh, therefore I'm going to take away my promise. But he does not do that. He responded to her sin of unbelief, but does not take away the promise. That's just like God, loving, long-suffering, and forgiving. Paul in 2 Timothy 2:13 sums up whether we believe God or not with these words. If we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot disown himself. I take this to mean that Sarah's unfaithfulness did not nullify God's faithfulness. Check these words out in Romans 3:3. What if some did not have faith? Will that lack of faith nullify God's faithfulness? I don't think so. According to verse 14 of chapter 18 of Genesis, the question is asked, is anything too hard for God? Let us proclaim this truth, saints. There is nothing too hard for God. Ministers and lay alike, as you read through Genesis and the rest of the Bible, you will discover that God, our Heavenly Father, has unlimited power. Satan has some power. When you're going through the worst of your troubles, you may drive across the state line to Georgia seeking out some help from a root doctor. But you don't have to do that. All you have to do is go to the throne of grace and ask God for what it is that you need. And I want you to know he will answer. Well, what kind of power does God have? He has the power to create. And he's fashioning some husbands for some folk right now. And some wives. He experienced no difficulty creating this vast universe. In our own galaxy, he created the sun, the moon, and the stars, and calls the stars by name. Only God can do that. He created plant life and animal life and sustains everything by the might of his power. God then created man and commanded him to be fruitful and multiply. But don't try to do it by yourself. Have mercy, Lord. Secondly, God has the power to liberate. He brought his people out of Egyptian and Babylonian bondage with great power. It was the same power that liberated our sun-kissed brothers and sisters from involuntary servitude in this country, which postulates that all men are created equal. Is there anything too hard for God? Look at God as he exercises his power with the prophets. He locked the jaws of hungry lions, allowing his servant Daniel to be set free without even a cat scratch. Let us never forget that it's not too hard for God to judge. Let me tell you about a biblical guy named Belshazzar in the book of Daniel. Belshazzar succeeded his grandfather Nebuchadnezzar as co-regent of Babylon. Daniel was God's instrument to warn Nebuchadnezzar and the succeeding kings of Babylon to submit to the true and living God rather than to the multitude of idols that they worshipped. Daniel not only gave sound advice to Nebuchadnezzar, but did the same for his grandson, Belshazzar. Because of his great pride, Belshazzar gave a great banquet for his nobles, his wives, and his concubines. Y'all know what that is, don't you? Both food and water were on the house. After the king became a little tipsy, he ordered that the gold and silver goblets that came from the temple in Jerusalem be brought to the banquet hall so they could drink out of them. We're talking about nothing being too hard for God. I want you to know that God's grace will eventually run out if we continue in our disobedience to his word, will, and way. Well, Belshazzar and his drinking buddies drank out of the vessels that were wholly set aside for God's use. Belshazzar learned nothing from his grandfather about honoring God. Think about us. The Lord had banished his grandfather, that is Belshazzar's grandfather, to the wilderness to eat grass like an ox. His hair had become like feathers, and his fingernails like bird claws. Nebuchadnezzar remained in this condition for 7 long years. Have mercy, Lord. Until he recognized that all of the kingdoms of the world belong to our sovereign God, and that he can give them to whomever he pleases. DJT, you are not the permanent president of the United States. And I must add this to And I would be remiss if I didn't. If you look at DJT, look at that middle initial. And you're wondering perhaps what that stands for. I want you to know the first part of that name is Jack. Belshazzar, through his strange actions, was mocking God. My brothers and sisters, Galatians 6:7 reminds us of this. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. In order to get Belshazzar's attention, our God caused a hand to write on the wall a message that frightened Belshazzar and all of his guests to helplessness. Everybody was drunk at one time. But when they saw the handwriting on the wall, everybody became sober. That is why we here in America must get it right. We cannot continue to do whatever we feel like doing and expect God to bless us. And in this country, we must let the church be the church. That's why my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ, the solid rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. It is not too hard for our great God to heal. He healed King Hezekiah, who was sick unto death. Isaiah tapped by the Lord to deliver this message to Hezekiah. Put your house in order, because you're going to die. You will not recover. Hezekiah, like any good, sensible Christian, turned his face to the wall and prayed to the Lord. Remember, Lord, how I have walked before you faithfully and with wholehearted devotion, and have done what is good in your sight. And Hezekiah wept bitterly. Before Isaiah left the middle court, the word of the Lord came to him, go back and tell Hezekiah, the ruler of my people, I'm going to give him 14 more years as king. Hallelujah. That was then. This is now. Now I want you to know that God is still in the healing business. How do I know? Because when my maternal grandmother was 35 years old, the doctors diagnosed her with tuberculosis and gave her 6 months to live. She was around 60. My Lord, we thought she was going to leave us, but the Lord allowed her to live until she was 106. Don't tell me God can't heal. And I want you to know it didn't stop there. I want you to know that I take some pride in thanking the Lord for my healing. For I was diagnosed with cancer twice, but the Lord healed me both times. And don't you think I have enough sense to tell him thank you, to give him glory, to give him praise for his wonder-working power? If the Lord has healed you, you ought to make some noise. There is nothing too hard for God, because his grace is sufficient. Yes, it is. It's grace. is sufficient. My Lord, there is nothing too hard for God because, yeah, his grace again is sufficient. That's what the Lord told Paul concerning his thorn in the flesh. God's grace is without measure. In other words, there are no scales that you can weigh it. There is no microscope or telescope that can see it. Have mercy, Lord. For example, there have been folk who have been adjudicated guilty for crimes they did not commit. Nevertheless, through grace, evidence was found to exonerate the innocent. My brothers and sisters, that is amazing grace. Thus, it is not a trite statement to make. God's grace woke me up this morning. I hope that you did not depend on the alarm clock to wake you up. If I had waited this morning for the alarm clock to wake me up, Postel's mortuary would have picked me up by now. Let me hurry on. I can tell you're getting a little weary. Because there is nothing too hard for God, he's able to reverse biological processes that do not work, permitting them to function above normality. An elderly man was asked how he felt. He replied, "Well, I tell you, pretty much everything hurts. And what doesn't hurt doesn't work." If that's your problem this evening, I want you to know that God has the power to correct whatever it is that ails you. We know for sure that it was grace that our God rebooted Sarah's womb and raised Abraham's testosterone to a new level. There may have been snow on the roof, but there was fire in the hearth. Right now, I'm going to step back and allow you to bask in your own sanctified imagination what characterized whatever else that may have taken place between Abraham and Sarah prior to Isaac's arrival on the planet. If God is able, my Lord, if God is able to create a live body, surely he's able to raise one from the dead. Won't he do it? Orlando District, there's nothing too hard for God. I know that we are living in dangerous times. Crime is ever present danger, no matter where we live. Nevertheless, no matter what happens, God still sits on the throne in glory. He sits high and he looks slow and sees all of the affairs of mankind. Well, it's about time for me to land the plane now regarding this message. If you are not convinced by now, there is nothing too hard for God. Additional proof will not help you. But perhaps you will believe that God is able to close doors that no man can open. He can open doors that no man can close. Is there anybody here other than me that can testify that he's able? If you believe that he's able, why don't you just give him some praise right now? I don't care what President Trump might say or what he might do. He is not in charge of this universe. God is in charge. And the last time I checked, he has not abdicated the throne in glory. He still occupies the throne. He's still in charge. He still has all power in his hand. If you believe it, say right now, he's able. He's able. He's able.
Come on, somebody, let's bless the Lord today. He's able. There's nothing too hard for God. Would you stand all over the church? The preacher has preached to us today. So we come to celebrate each of us being Christians, men and women of God, stewards, trustees, stewardesses, deaconesses, our honorees today. God is able. I don't care what you may be going through. I don't care what you've been through. Tell your neighbor, God is able. There's nothing too hard for God. He's a God that will fix whatever you need fixing right now. I don't care how young you are, how old you are, but trouble may be in your life, but God will fix it. He'll fix it for you. So we ask you to come now. Receive salvation. Come now. Receive deliverance. Come now. Receive healing. Come now. Receive prayer. Whatever you have that God wants to take it from you, if it's trouble in your way, God will take it from you. If it's tears in your eyes, He'll replace it with joy. As the choir sang, wanted you to know that it's nothing, nothing impossible with God. I'm a living witness that the Lord will heal your body. Hallelujah. Come on, come on, come on, all over the church. You here today? Come, come, come. Come today, come, come. Come on, come on, come on. Come, come, come. Come on, men. I want the men. Just come stand behind this brother. All the men pastors. Just come stand behind this brother. We know Brother Vax. He wants the Lord to feel him so that he'll be steadfast, unmovable. You all put a hedge around him. Join hands, men of God. Put a hedge around Brother Bats. His soul needs God. His spirit needs God. His mind needs God. And so God, right now, these men are standing in the gap. He realizes there's nothing too hard for you, God, in the name of Jesus. Oh God, we ask you to make him steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in your love, Lord God, giving strength in his mind right now in the name of Jesus. Let him hunger and thirst after your righteousness, God, because you have called him for an hour such as this. So bless him, God. Bless him, Lord, right now. Give him power right now, God. Give him peace right now, God. Give him purpose right now, God. Every promise from Genesis to Revelation, all that you have for him, give it to him right now, God, in the name of Jesus. And as he lifts his hands up to you right now in the name of Jesus, and surrender all to you right now, God, in the name of Jesus. The enemy can have no more jurisdiction over him in the name of Jesus, because he belongs totally to you. And we give you glory and honor in the name of Jesus, we pray. And the men and women of God say amen, amen, and amen. Come on, be blessed with the Lord. Come on, put your hands together. Come on, put your hands together.
Bye. rest in Him. Just rest in the Lord. Just rest in the Lord. Just rest in the Lord. Rest in the Lord. Every fiber of your body, every ache, every pain, leaving your body right now in the name of Jesus. Come on, take a deep breath. Cough it out. Shut to the bush. Cough it out. In Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, put your hands together. Give Lord a praise offering. We're blessing Him today. Amen. Thank you, men of God. Thank you so much for standing in the gap. Amen. God bless you. All over the church.
Come on, give God a hand all over the house. Somebody tell him it's done. In Jesus' name. My God. Come on, give God another hand. Now give him a hand for a mighty word. Amen. I'm going to tell you, he ain't preached like he was 85, did he? My Lord. Praise be to the Lord. Amen. A mighty word from the Lord. Amen. Thank you so very much. Amen. We're coming at a time of giving for the Lord. Come on, give a hand for the Lord for just being able to give all over the house. Come on, give a big hand for the Lord for just being able to give. We thank God for the blessings of giving. And as you come now and giving your offering, what we are asking everybody who can that would give us $25 in this offering. Everybody who can. If you can't do that, do as close as you can to it. Amen? Come on, say amen. And so we want to just thank God for the blessedness of His love and thank God for the blessedness of His giving. Amen. All over the house, that God is a marvelous and a good God. God is a loving God. Amen? Now, I want to remind you again, we say in the house, if you're going to give an offering, if you just start balling it up, straighten it up. Straighten it up. Don't bring any ball up money. And I want you to know this. If you on the short side and you don't want folk to know what you're giving, go on or straighten it up. Because if you on the short side, God need to know it. And if you hide it, God will act like he don't see it. And so, and if you are really short, God will meet you in your shortness. Amen. And provide according to your need. Amen. So, amen. So if you would get your gifts out of now, hold them up. Hold them up. Hold them up. Praise be to the Lord. Hold them up. Hold them up before the Lord. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Now together, Lord, I'm giving my gift. I'm giving it in faith. I'm giving it in obedience. And I'm trusting you, God, to meet me in my giving. I'm trusting you, God, to bless me in my giving. I'm trusting you, God, to even bless beyond my giving. In the name of Jesus. Lord, I thank you, and I praise you, and I glorify you with my gift. Lord, I bless it in the name of Jesus. Now, come on, put your hand together and say amen. Come on, bless the Lord all over the house. Come on, give him a big blessing all over the house for what you're about to do. Amen. Praise the Lord. Ushers, would you help us out? Amen. All checks, please make them out to the Orlando district. Amen. All pastors who have not, please see Reverend McIntyre. If you have not, please make sure you see Reverend McIntyre. Opportunity to give. and let us praise God from whom all blessings flow. All. I know what I'm doing. I want you to praise God from whom all blessings flow. I meant to say that. It's not an accident. Because I want you to tell him, because you want him to keep flowing. Now. The church say amen.
Amen.
Now, we're going to have, after we dismiss, we'll do the communion. But after the communion and we get ready to dismiss, we have a meal for everybody in the fellowship hall. Amen. Go and give that a hand. Okay. And so what we want to do is, though, we want those special persons, 75 and over, our honorees, to be able to go first. So we ask that you would allow them to go out first, amen, and they will be the first ones that will be served, amen. And so we ask that you would help us out and help him get them there so they'll be the first one to be served. Those persons who want to go and sit down and eat can sit down with us. Those who don't want to can dare to take out and take it home, amen. Now, we want you to come back early in the morning. Breakfast will start at 8 o'clock in the morning. We'll go from 8 to 9 o'clock, breakfast and fellowship. At 8:45, amen, at 8:45 we will start devotion, which will be led by the ministers. And then at 9 o'clock we'll have the greeting from our presiding elders, and we'll be starting with our from greetings and our roll call, amen. So we ask you just God bless you. Get a good night's sleep. And y'all do come back now. You hear? All right. Praise the Lord. Come on, give God a hand. Amen. We thank God for the blessedness as we, amen, makes preparations now for our time of communion with God.
Ye that do truly and earnestly repent of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbor and intend to lead a new life following the commandments of God, draw near with faith. Make your humble confession to Almighty God, meekly kneeling. Let us join in the general confession. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, make of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and dwell in manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most faithfully have committed by thought, word, and deed against your divine majesty. Provoking most justly your wrath and indignation against us, we do earnestly repent and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous to us. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us. Most merciful Father, for your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past and grant that we may hereafter, in the newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of thy tender mercy did give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death on the cross for our redemption, who made thereby his oblation of himself, once offered a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute and in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memory of that his precious death until his coming again. Hear us, O merciful Father, we most humbly beseech thee, and grant that we, receiving these thy creatures of bread and wine, according to thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, Holy Institute, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood, who in the same night that he was betrayed, he took bread. When he broke it, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Eat, this is my body, which is broken for you." Right after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of it. For this is my blood of the New Testament, which was shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as often as ye shall do it in remembrance of me." Body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, broken for me on Calvary, I eat this in remembrance that Christ died for me. Yeah. Precious blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, yeah, shed for me on Calvary, I drink it in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for me. Amen. Savior Jesus Christ, broken for you on Calvary, may it preserve your soul and body unto everlasting life. Body of our Lord, Savior Jesus Christ, broken for you on Calvary, may it preserve your soul and body unto everlasting life. Blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, drink it in remembrance of Christ's blood was shed for you. Precious blood, redeeming blood, saving blood, precious blood. Drink it in the remembrance of Christ's blood was shed for you. Blood of our Lord, Savior Jesus Christ. Drink it in remembrance Christ's blood was shed for you. You may arise. Having renewed your covenant, may the Lord bless you and keep you. This is our prayer.
Arise, my father's children, and go in peace as these go, let others come. Make your humble confession, meekly kneeling upon your knees. Arise, my father's children, and go in peace. As these go, let others come. Make your humble confession, meekly kneeling upon your knees. Arise, my father's children, go in peace. As these go, let others come. Let's get at the sheriff. Stand here and do what I'm
make your humble confession to Almighty God by meekly kneeling upon your knees. You who have shown that by partaking this sacrament that you intend to lead new life following the ways and commandments of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, arise, my father's children, and go in peace. And as these depart, let others draw nigh. You may make your humble confession to Almighty God by meekly kneeling upon your knees. You have shown that by partaking of this sacrament that you intend to lead a new life following the ways and commandments of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Arise, my Father's children, and go in peace. And as these depart, let others draw nigh. Brothers and sisters, you may make your humble confession to Almighty God by meekly kneeling upon your knees. You who have shown that by partaking of this sacrament that you intend to lead new life following the ways and commandments of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, arise, my Father's children, and go in peace. And as these depart, let others draw nigh. Brothers and sisters, you may make humble confession to Almighty God by meekly kneeling upon your knees. You who have shown that by partaking of this sacrament that you intend to lead new life following the ways and commandments of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, arise, my Father's children, and go in peace. And as these depart, let others draw nigh. Brothers and sisters, you may make your humble confession to Almighty God by meekly kneeling upon your knees. And you who have shown that by partaking of this sacrament that you intend to lead new life following the ways and commandments of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, arise, my Father's children, and go in peace. And as these depart, let others draw nigh. Let us stand. As we invite the stewardess of the church to make a humble confession to Almighty God by meekly kneeling upon your knees.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. We're going to get ready to close our Holy Communion, but Dr. Bird and Sister Bird has another engagement. So would you put your hands together and thank God for the powerful word, them coming to be with us today. Amen. And we're going to allow them to go ahead and leave at this time. Reverend Cheryl Moore will escort them out. Sister Bird, amen. Got two more to go? All right. Praise the Lord while they're doing that. You all get to school, Dr. Bird. Thank you so much, Dr. Bird. Thank you for your love. Take your jacket. Mm-hmm. Get all of his stuff.
One more time, would you give Dr. Bird a hand? I thank him so much for coming to be with us. Amen. All right, we have two more to be served. You all have them. All right. All right, is that everybody? All righty. Pastor. Where's the top? Took it to the back. She said, just make one stack. Let us repeat the Lord's Prayer.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever. Amen. God of grace, we give you praise and thanks for the daily communion of the body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We pledge our redemption, and we pray that it brings us forgiveness of our sins, strength in our weaknesses, everlasting salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ and Savior. Let us say amen.
So, our stewardesses may return to their seats. Amen. Praise God. All right, at this time, would you all put your hands together once again for our honorees? And we will ask that the ushers will escort our honorees out. They can hear the benediction in the fellowship hall. All of our honorees, 75 and older, you'll be escorted to the dining room. If you don't want to stay and eat, then they will have your plates ready for you to go. Amen. She said, go ahead, she'll give her time. We want to thank again all of our stewards. Would you please raise your hand? All of our stewards all over the building. Amen. All of our trustees all over the building. Would you raise your hand? Praise the Lord. All of our stewardesses, we want to thank you so much for coming today. All of our ministers of the gospel, we thank you. Brother Roe is on the other side. But now, next time, Brother Roe, you're on this side. All right, that's one of my new ministers, Brother Roe. All right, and all of our pastors again, we thank you so much. Dr. Ivy, please don't leave without seeing me. Would you come up front? Let us just recognize your presence. Amen. Let us just recognize our presence of our Conference President of the Women's Missionary Society. Would you all put your hands together and give her a hand as she just comes, that we may recognize her. Traveled all the way from Daytona. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. While they're getting our seniors out, would you just say hello to us?
Good evening. To God be the glory. It is truly a blessing to be here with you in your opening worship service as you prepare to do the work of God. You have a wonderful leader who's spirit-led, And may God bless you over the next few days as you conduct the business of the district. On behalf of the Women's Missionary Society and the Young People's and Children's Division of the Central Conference, we thank you for all that you do, and may God bless each of you greatly.
Amen. Praise God.
Good evening. I just wanted to make one additional announcement. Our pastor, Pastor Mark Crutcher, Pastor Mark Crutcher, he's our pastor here at Mount Olive AME Church. He has been here 9 years, and as most of you know, that's the record for Mount Olive. So we are very, very happy that he has been with us 9 years. We're going to be celebrating his anniversary on March the 10th. And we here at Mount Olive, we're having a banquet with entertainment. Pastor may even dance, he told us. So we would like to invite all of you to our celebration. We have tickets for the banquet, which includes entertainment and so forth, for $40. They'll be available out in the narthex, so just see one of the folks at the table out there. And we would love to have every single one of you come and celebrate with us on our pastor's 9th anniversary here at Mount Olive. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Amen. Last but not least, would you put your hands together for this outstanding Orlando District Choir who sung out of their souls today. I see some of them have already exited, but we want you all to know that we love you so much. And elders just got to give you a pizza party or something. Praise the Lord. You all were just marvelous, just simply marvelous. And to our ushers of Mount Olive AME Church, I see you. We thank you so much for all that you have done for us. And would you celebrate our minister of music, Reverend Vincent Smith, and his accompany, Reverend Kendrick Shaw. Amen. And all the drummer, Brother Andreas Campbell, and just each of you for having our service. Now, I know our service is a little long, but I promise you, this is the only elder that has one afternoon and one full day. Amen. Well, I take it back. Reverend Thompson does the same thing. So you have to come back and forth. So I know this service is a little long, but it's to celebrate us together and we commune together as a district. I appreciate all that you do. If you do not want to stay and eat, they have the takeout around the back, and you may take your plates with you. They're already fixed and ready to go. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. I also celebrate our host pastor and our first lady and all the members of Mount Olive AME Church. Thank you so much.
Is there anything too hard for God? We ask now that the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, that you rest, rule, and abide with us now, henceforth, and forevermore. In the name of Jesus, let all of God's children say, go on, say it again. One more time.